most of you will know certainly of him, if not know Sir Gillian. He's the president of the Wildflower Society. And so in your magazine, you see very often at the front of the magazine, a piece from Sir Gillian about botany in some way, shape or form for us. If you attend our AGMs, he often puts in an appearance very kindly at our AGMs for us. So that's also very nice when you can see him in person and talk to him in person. I looked up, as one does, on Wikipedia about Sir Gillian prior to this talk. I knew he had an impressive botanical background. I didn't quite realise quite what an extensive botanical background he has. From his early days, he got a botany degree, as you would perhaps have thought. And one of his earlier jobs or career in his career path was at the New York Botanical Gardens, where he spent a good deal of time as he worked for the New York Botanical Gardens. He spent a good deal of his time in the Amazon region of Brazil, which I think we might hear just a little bit about, and certainly about some things that he knows about from that time. So there where he started in the New York Botanical Gardens in an early part of his career, and at the end of his career, he was involved in the Eden Project, on the way, going via director of the Royal Botanic Gardens Kew, amongst other things. He picked up an amazing, impressive number of honours. I just share them with you for a minute, just because they're sort of quite interesting and varied. He was knighted in 1995, a fellow and president of the Linnaean Society, fellow of the Royal Society, the Victorian Medal of Honour, the Order of the Southern Cross awarded in Brazil, and the Order of the Rising Sun in Japan. I think, Sir Gillian, you have travelled during your career. And last but not least in Wikipedia, it was just sort of rather warming to read that it actually had, and president of the Wildflower Society since 2003. Welcome, Sir Gillian. Would you like to share your screen? Can you take yourself off mute, please? Thank you.
Right. I'm glad that they mentioned the Wildflower Society.
Yes.
I'm trying to share my screen now.
Yeah.
Is it coming up?
It does take a second or two when you do it.
Right. Well, I've pressed on the green button and it hasn't come up yet. You've allowed me to, have you?
I have allowed you to share screen. So you need to press share screen.
Which I've done several times now.
That's right. It's happening now. You started sharing your screen.
Here we go.
Now you need to launch your slideshow.
I'm just launching slideshow at the moment. Yes.
There is a sort of delay always to this.
Yes, it's delaying at the moment, but it's working, I think. Right.
We're off. Thank you very much.
Apologies for the delay, but we're off now. And good evening, everybody. And it's always a pleasure to do something with the Wildflower Society, which I was a member as a boy. Mm. And I was abroad for a long time and it was a lapse. Then I came back into it when I came back to the UK. Well, as you heard in the introduction, I spent a lot of time in the Amazon, so I decided I'd talk mainly about some of the interesting Amazon plants that I've seen. So now you should be looking at the water hyacinth, which is a very beautiful plant, and you can see why it was introduced into a horticultural exhibit in Louisiana, and then it escaped into the drainage in Florida and other places, and it is a terrific weed in many parts of the world, but it's a beautiful plant in the Amazon where the natural predators control it. And then the arum lily, you know, cuckoo pint, the small one that we have, but they're large woody ones in the Amazon. So this is one called Montricardia, which is tree-like, and it grows all along the Amazon rivers. So I'm starting with some of the aquatic plants of the Amazon. And my favorite one is the giant Amazon water lily, Victoria Amazonica, named after our Queen Victoria. And Amazonica used to be called Victoria Regia. That was an illegal name. I think in a recent talk, you heard about changing of botanical names. When I pointed out that the real name of this was Victoria Amazonica, the papers in Brazil said, were quite furious about this because they liked it as Victoria Regia. And they were saying rude things about the British botanist, that's me, that had changed the name. But it was actually Sowerby in 1850 that changed the name to Victoria Amazonica. So it was not a recent change. Look at the under surface of the leaf. It's just quite an incredible structure. Those veins are air-filled, and so that's why the leaves float on the surface so well. And when it was grown in Chatsworth, Paxton saw this and it flowered, and that was his inspiration for the design of the Crystal Palace in the great exhibit in Hyde Park in London. And so it's one of the plants that influenced architects. And look at this. It can bear quite a weight. I had a very nervous mother of one of my staff at Kew when we tried this experiment. But yes, a child can float on the leaf of the Victoria water lily. Now, these are the buds gradually opening. On the top left, you see a very young bud. And then you see one of the sepals opening on the right-hand side. When it gets dark, the flower begins to open. This probably means that over on this side on the left is in the east side where it's much darker. In the west, still sunset. So it's opening gradually. And as it opens, see down below, something beginning to come to it. That is a beetle, a scarab beetle. And then the flower gradually opens. It's wonderful to be on a lake in a canoe and see all these stars opening on the lake. This time, it's a white flower. It's opened at darkness. And you'll notice on these photos, there's something sticking out of the side of the flower. That's my thermometer measuring, because the flower temperature is about 11 degrees centigrade warmer than ambient temperature. And it's emitting a strong scent. And that's what attracts the beetles to the flower. And here we have two different species of scarab beetles on the left. One of them, the one I'm pointing at now, was a new species when we discovered it. The beetles enter the flower, and inside the flower there are these knobs, pericarpals, that are full of starch and sugar, just what the beetles like to eat. So they're very happy inside the cavity in the middle of the flower. Then, during the night, the flower begins to close again, and you can see it's changing color gradually. There's a tint of pink or purple in this flower, and it's closed up with maybe 6 to 20 beetles inside it. They're quite happy, it's warm, and there's food for them in there, so they're not in a hurry to get out. And then during the day, the flower changes colour. And this is a Victoria flower on the next day in the late afternoon. And you can see that the colour's different, but the flower is no longer hot. There's no longer a temperature change. And then you can see, looking at the flower, how these pericarpels are tightly closed and there's only a small breathing hole in the middle. But as it gets dark the next day, those open up and the beetles emerge. And see this beetle here, its elytra is covered with pollen, because as the flowers open on the second day, the pollen is produced and the beetles get covered with it, and then they fly on to another flower. And since the Victoria produces a flower every other day, it will take it to a different plant. And so that's a wonderful way of cross-pollination and a wonderful relationship between a beetle and a water lily. I spent a lot of time wading in these lakes to do about a year's worth of continuous observations on that to get all these data. Now, another plant that's one of my favorites is the Brazil nut. I bet most of you have eaten Brazil nuts at some time or other. And there is a Brazil nut tree. It's one outside the forest a bit so that I could get a photo of the whole tree. But the Brazil nuts are produced in a large fruit at the top of those trees. It's about the size, a bit bigger than a cricket ball, and the nuts are arranged like the segments of an orange inside it. So that's how the Brazil nuts grow. Now you'll see here that this outer shell is very hard, and at the top there's a little hole and a plug in that hole. I'll come back to that in a minute, but that's what the Brazil nut looks like. Well, the flowers of the Brazil nut have a sort of hood over the top, and only a large bee could push its way into that flower. You can see here the bee trying to lift that hood to get the nectar in the base of it. And there is the bee right inside. And the back of the bee is rubbing against the stamens and so getting full of pollen. Now, the Brazil nut is something that needs cross-pollination. The pollen needs to go from one tree to another. So the bees, when they've got their full fill of nectar, may fly on to another tree and cause cross-pollination. But here is one of those same bees. They're called orchid bees because they like to go to orchids. And it's the male bees that go to the Brazil nuts, and they put the scent of the Brazil nut the male bee that goes to the orchids, and they put the scent of the orchids in their hind legs in special pockets, and they use that to attract the female bees for mating. And so to get the Brazil nuts to eat, we need those bees, we need the orchids, and then it doesn't stop there because that big fruit falls off the tree onto the ground. And there's only one animal that is big enough to, or is able to open the Brazil nut with its sharp teeth, the agouti, a guinea pig-like rodent, of course, much bigger than a guinea pig. So that's a story behind the Brazil nuts that you might eat at Christmas, but you need a bee, an orchid, and an agouti for the Brazil nut to continue its life. And most of the Brazil nuts that we get, in fact, almost all, come from wild trees because you can't cultivate them well unless you maintain that cycle of pollination with the bees and the orchids. And so it's a good organic crop because it comes from the forests of Brazil, Bolivia, and Peru, where the Brazil nut species grows. That sort of relationship, though, is not just confined to the Brazil nut. I have studied the 250 species in the Brazil nut family called Lecithidaceae, and here's just one more of them. And it's, you can see its Latin name, Corythophora, in the middle there. And here is a little bee, an Eudrosyne bee. It's a smaller flower than a Brazil nut. And there the bee is inside this flower, gathering the nectar. But here is the male of this bee in a Sobralia orchid, gathering the scent of the orchid. And so when they come together and mating takes place, then the bee will propagate, but also the Corythophora will get its pollination. I've studied that in a whole lot of different members of the Brazil nut family with different bees and different orchids that are involved. So the Amazon orchids are quite important in the pollination of the members of the Brazil nut family, Lecithidaceae. But here's another member of the Lecithidaceae, and this is called the monkey pot. And look at those seeds, black seeds with a very fleshy stalk at the bottom. And this one's different from the Brazil nut. The top just falls off automatically from the tree, and this fruit is left hanging on the tree. And as soon as the cap falls off, bats come in and they take those seeds out and they fly across the forest and they eat the fleshy stalk and drop the seeds. So the bats distribute the Brazil nut, the sapucaia nut, around the forest. So the Brazil nut has a guti on the ground to take its seeds and bury them, but the sapucaia has bats that cart it around. Then perhaps one of the most cultivated around the world in the tropics, members of the Brazil nut family, is the cannonball tree. You can see here how it's called a cannonball because it's just a round cannonball-like fruit. I wondered for years, how did the cannonball fruit get its fruit around? Because they fall off whole like the Brazil nut, but I'd never seen agoutis eating them. And one day when we were in the forest having our lunch, we heard a herd of pigs coming through the forest. And those pigs came and they ate the cannonball tree fruit and they carry the seeds that pass through their guts. So that too is another interesting story. But the cannonball is also interesting because the flower, like the Brazil nut, has a hood over it and then a ring of stamens around the base, as you see on the left. And I hope you can see that I'm pointing to. Well, what is interesting is that these stamens in the hood here don't germinate if you put them in a germination fluid, but the ones around here do. So a bee lands here and it feeds on these stamens to eat the pollen, but its back rubs on these ones and the ring, and so it gets dusted. And that is how the cannonball gets pollinated. So that too is fascinating, with two types of pollen, one that germinates and one that doesn't. One more member of the Brazil nut family to show you. This is Gustavia. And this one is a more simple flower. Bees just enter in there and get the pollen out. But it's a beautiful flower. And you can see why Linnaeus named this one after King Gustav III of Sweden. So named after his king. So we've seen tonight water lily named after our queen. And here is a tree in the Amazon named after the king of Sweden by Linnaeus many, many years ago. But there are lots of other beautiful members of the Brazil nut family, like this one called Corythophora. Even more complicated flower inside that requires a very long tongue bee to pollinate it. So here's a dissection of the flower, and you can see this hood is much more complicated than in the other ones. And when I was looking at this in the laboratory when I was a student at Oxford, I predicted that it would need a long tongue bee to get in to reach the nectar that's right in the middle there. It wasn't till 30 years later I saw that, I saw that in the forest and saw that it was one of those long-tongued orchid bees that could reach the pollen in the middle of that flower. So that's the Brazil nut family, several species of it. There are lots of beautiful flowers in the Amazon. This one called Platonia is actually now, with the change of classification that we have, used to be in a family called the Gutiferae, but that is now united with the Hypericaceae. And so it is actually a member of the Hypericaceae. Doesn't look very like our St. John's worts, does it? But it produces a very nice edible fruit, one of the fruits that I've enjoyed many times in the Amazon. Now, one of the things in my studies I've done a lot of, as you can see already talking about Victorian and Brazil nuts, is pollination. And very important in pollination of Amazon plants are bats. So here is the wing of a bat there, wrapped around a parkia flower. The bat is sucking nectar at the base here, and its stomach and its wing touch the stamens here, and then it flies away from one tree to another. Bats are very important pollinators of plants in the tropics, in all the rainforests of the world. There are lots of interesting bats that do the pollination. And so I show you one or two examples of some of the bat-pollinated flowers. This one, Pseudobombax, in the plant family called the Bombaceae, is a riverside plant. It grows beside many of the rivers in the Amazon. And you can see that flower, which is a mass of stamens sticking out. And there's nectar at the base of those. And when a bat goes in there to get the nectar, you can see it would get completely dusted with pollen. So it's a very good way of getting their pollen from one tree to the next one. Bombax, or the Munguba tree, in fact, the Latin name is the same as the local name in Portuguese, Munguba. And this one is a member of the caper family, the Caparidaceae, Creativa. And this is a plant that grows along the riversides. And so it's right beside the water. And the bats can fly freely along the corridors of the rivers. And so it's of easy access. And again, you can see a flower that is sticking up with the stamen sticking up. And so the bats can easily get to the nectar and get dusted with the pollen. So it's another very typically bat-pollinated flower. But this one's a bit different. Many of the bat-pollinated flowers are not attractive colors. Ones that attract bees and butterflies and other insects often have bright colors. But many of the bat ones don't, because they don't need color. The bats are attracted by the scent more. And so they fly mainly at night. So color's not important. So this is a flower of a bat pollinated plant that is produced on the stem and trunk of the tree. So again, it's easily accessible to the bats. This plant is the gourd of the Amazon called the calabash. And so that is the flower of the calabash. And here are the fruits of the calabash. On the left-hand side, you can see a young calabash. And on it, you see little white dots. Those are nectaries. And also there are black things. Those are ants. The nectaries feed the ants. And if I were to put my finger onto that particular plant, the ants would attack it. So the ants are protecting the young calabash fruit as it develops. Then it swells up, so it's about the size of a football, and then it's hard and woody, and you can see there's no sign of the nectar or the ants on the fruit on the right-hand side of the picture. Well, this is a very useful plant. It's the gourd of the Amazon. They use it to make soup bowls, canoe balers, all sorts of other uses. So these children here would not have the soup bowl out of which they're drinking here if it wasn't for the work of an ant that had protected the young fruit, and then bats that had pollinated it. And then the mother can collect those fruits, take out the pulp from the middle, use that hard outer shell, stain it with the paint from the bark of another tree, and make very nice soup bowls for them to eat their soup. Another plant family I've worked on is called the golden fruited family, the Chrysobalanaceae. And this is one member of it. And it's very interesting. In the calabash, I told you how the ants protect the fruit. In this one, which is a very beautiful flower, you can see on the right-hand side, the base of a leaf with two swollen chambers. And in those chambers, they're really ants' nests. They're full of ants. And those ants protect the plant. And if an insect wants to come and eat the leaf, the ants will attack it. So ants are very important for protecting fruits and leaves in the Amazon. We did an experiment where we put some of these plants where we excluded the ants, and then lots of other things ate the leaf of the plant, but the ones that were our control with the ants in them, they were not eaten at all. So we showed that this is the case. The plant is well protected by the ants that live in these cavities at the base of the leaf called dermatia. I have done a lot of work with the local people who live in the Amazon. I love them, and I've done a lot of study of how they use plants. This lecture is not about that. Maybe another time I can talk to the society about ethnobotany, which is the use of plants by people. But I just put a couple in to show you. This one is the main red body paint of the Amazon Indians, used by almost all the tribes. Bixa, and you can see its name in Portuguese, Urucum, or Achiote in Spanish. But in English, we call it the lipstick plant. And it is used in the perfume industry to dye various perfumes. It's used in Brazil to dye foods. And so it's quite an important economic plant, as well as having been the body paint of many of the Amazon tribes. But one of the interesting things in this is that it's been shown that the red dye on the skin repels insects. So my question is, did they begin to use this as an insect repellent or as a decoration? Who knows? But it is nevertheless a very important plant to the Amazon Indians. And here's another interesting plant, the Genipapo, Genipa americana. And what's that got to do with the Indian on the right-hand side? Well, that baby was sick. And the jenipapo is the black dye in their body paint. And they believe that one of the things they had to do was dye the baby's skin black as part of the cure for the whatever was wrong with it. But it's a very important black dye of many of the tribes of Indians. So those are just two of the many plants that I've studied that are used by the local people in the Amazon. The dogbane family, Apocynaceae, is an interesting one, has many, many poisonous plants in it, including one called Hemadanthus. But what is interesting is, nearly always when I see this plant, I see a group of these caterpillars on the plant eating the leaves. And it wasn't until a bit later that I read in the entomological literature a bit more about this connection. But the caterpillars eat the poisonous leaves, and then the caterpillars themselves are poisonous, and so they are protected from birds that eat caterpillars. They taste one of those once, and they'll never eat another one because they're foul-tasting and poisonous to the birds. So the caterpillar has made use of this, and that poison is passed on to the moth that that comes from the caterpillar. Rather similar to the relationship of the monarch butterfly, whose caterpillars eat the poisonous plants in the same family, in the Asclepiadaceae, the Asclepiads. This is an interesting plant, and it's another one with a story. Paulinia cupana, and you can see below its Brazilian name, Guaraná. Well, if you go to Brazil, instead of drinking Coca-Cola, you drink Guaraná, which is a caffeine-based drink based on the pulp from the black seeds that you can see in this photo. But this has been used by the Indians for countless generations, long before Westerners came to the Amazon. So they got their daily dose of caffeine before they went out hunting by grinding down those seeds and taking a drink, mixing it with water and drinking it. Now, there are many interesting stories about this, and it's mainly the Mauez Indians that now use and cultivate this plant today. And they believe that many, many generations ago, their tribe was being overrun by other Indians. And the good God said, "Don't worry about this, I'll send something to save you." And the chief had a very precocious boy, son, and he began to lead them, and they began to prosper. And then the evil God didn't like this, and he turned himself into a snake and climbed up into the favorite fruit tree of that boy and struck him, and he died. And there was great sadness in the tribe. And then the good God said, "Don't worry, plant the eyes of the boy." And they did that, and out came from that the Guaraná. Now, there are many sort of legends like that amongst the local people connected to the useful plants that they use. And there's a legend for the Victoria water lily I began with, but I obviously don't have time to talk about many of these legends, but that's just one of the origins of a plant that is very useful to the Indians. Those sort of plants that have fruit that look red and stick out like this are attractive to birds. Birds love red. So in actual fact, the Guaraná was a plant that was dispersed in the forest by birds. And this is another one, member with a bean family, as you can see, with a sort of pod with red seeds. But these ones are not fleshy at all. They're hard, and actually the Indians use them as beads. But when a bird is deceived and picks them up, the seeds just pass through the bird, and the bird flies across the forest and excretes them in different places in the forest. So this is another way of getting your seeds around in the Amazon forest. Here's another plant that you probably know the product of, another useful plant that was cultivated and used by the Indians long before Westerners came. It is the cacao, or Theobroma cacao, the chocolate plant. I bet most of you like chocolate or cocoa or something like that, but this is the plant that it comes from, and it is a native of the Amazon rainforest. And when Linnaeus learned about it and learned how it was revered, was even a currency in Mexico, he thought, well, this plant with this wonderful taste that was so revered and worshipped by the Mexicans, he named it Theobroma, food of the gods, Theos, God, Broma, food. So he called it Theobroma cacao, using the local name there, which was cacao. And from that, eventually, we've got our name, chocolate. So it's from the seeds inside this pod, which are surrounded by a fleshy pulp that's quite juicy and nice, that my children loved when we lived in the Amazon. But it's the seeds that they dry and pulverize to get chocolate. But this one is another member of Theobroma, that's much larger, about the size of a rugby ball. And it's called cupu açu in Brazil. And it too makes a very nice white chocolate, but it's not so well known. But in the Amazon, everybody likes to make cupu açu ice cream or cupu açu pudding of some sort, because it has an even more delicious flavor from the pulp surrounding the seeds, not the seeds. And cupu is the Tupi local name for the cacao plant, and açu just means large in Tupi. So it means a large chocolate plant, cupu açu. And it's one that I am very fond of, and soon as I go to Brazil, one of the first things I want is a cupu açu ice cream. Some plants look a bit more like the ones that you know. So there are members of the Solanaceae, the nightshade family, and you can see a flower down in the bottom there that looks just like the nightshades, the solanum we know, and the fruits of it. But I've collected a solanum in the same genus Solanum that is a tree 20 meters tall. So they're not necessarily like the woody nightshade that we know here in the UK. They may even grow up to tree size. Solanum is a very large genus with over 1,000 species, and it comes in all different sorts and generally with very many different poisons in it too. Here's a nice member of the Convolvulaceae family that grows beside the rivers in the Amazon, Maripa scandens. It's a climbing, scandens means climbing, and so like most Convolvulaceae, it is a climbing plant, but it climbs over the plants beside the river, so it looks rather beautiful with its blue flowers, which is rather an uncommon color in Amazon flowers. You probably, I hope, as wildflower enthusiasts have collected or seen birthwort somewhere, Aristolochia, where there are a lot of species of Aristolochia in the tropics. And this is just show you one of the Amazon ones. And you can see the sort of colours, fleshy looking colours, and it smells like rotting flesh, and flies come to it and they go inside it and they get trapped by those hairs. So they go around inside and they get dusted with pollen. After about 24 hours in the flower, those hairs wilt and the flowers can escape, the flies can escape and take the pollen on to another flower. So they have an interesting story too. And it's interesting, it's called birthwork in English because they think that it was used as an abortifacient. And one of the Indian tribes that I studied also used an aristolochia as an abortifacient. Violets are small, beautiful plants. There are one or two coming into flower around here in Dorset at the moment, this premature spring. But this is an Amazon member of the Violaceae, much larger, and this is taken from a tree. There are several violet tree genera in the Amazon. Coronistylus, this one's called. You can see the name Arborea, the tree one. But look at those long flowers with the tube here, the spur, and there's nectar at the end of the spur. And it's interesting that this is white flowered. It's very strongly perfumed at night. And the hawk moths come here, they hover, and their tongue goes down to the end of the flower there. So it is pollinated by hawk moths. This one, Clusia, another member of the, now the Hypericaceae, not the Clusiaceae, as it says here anymore, but it has waxy around the flower. And bees collect that wax to build their comb. And so it is pollinated by bees that gather wax rather than nectar or pollen. There are many species of Clusia. Here are just two. I think I've collected over 50 in the course of my work in the Amazon, but they're also rather attractive plants too. Some of them are trees, some of them are strangling plants that wrap themselves around other trees, and some of them are rather small that grow over rocks. The Combretaceae family, or Combretum. This is typical colour of a butterfly-pollinated plant, one that hangs over the rivers, and you can see those stamens sticking up in the flower here. And so when a butterfly lands, its body will rub against those stamens there and carry the pollen on to another Combretum flower. Interestingly enough, I once saw some capuchin monkeys coming and stealing the nectar from a Combretum, and they were absolutely covered with pollen all over their chests. So I wrote a paper saying secondary pollen of Combretum by capuchin monkeys. So occasionally they're pollinated by monkeys, not by the pollinator with which they evolve, the butterfly. Another one that attracts butterflies, you see that same color in this one, in the mistletoe family. There are also a lot of mistletoes in the Amazon. And this is just one of them in the genus called Psittacanthus in the mistletoe or the Laurentaceae. Looks a bit more attractive and striking than our mistletoe, but exactly the same. It's a hemiparasite growing on other trees in the Amazon. You can see another one that's again a similar sort of colors attracting butterflies in a family, a tropical family called the Marcgraviaceae. The Rubiaceae family that we know very well from the madders, but they are a large family in the Amazon, and I show this particular one for Sicaria because it has these long flowers with a long tube, and butterfly moths pollinate it with a long tongue that can reach the nectar at the base of those flowers. So that's what the Rubiaceae does in the Amazon. The willow herbs, another family we know well in the UK, but they look a bit different. And several of them are aquatic plants. Here are two members of the genus Ludwigia, the largest genus of Onagraceae in the Amazon region. And this one has floating leaves, and it's a wonderful arrangement of leaves, just like the arrangement of a pineapple fruit or many other fruits in the Fibonacci theory, which is the way that the leaves get the most light onto them possible. And this one is rooted in the base of the various lakes in the Amazon. So one that's floating and one that's rooted, to show you what a willow herb looks like in the Amazon. But here you can see more clearly this arrangement of the leaves, very attractive. And there are many plants that have this Fibonacci series of arrangement for their leaves. Passion flowers are abundant in the Amazon. And here are just four of species of passiflora in the passion flower family. One of them, not these ones here, has an edible fruit, the passion fruit, that we can now buy in supermarkets here sometimes. That's very delicious and certainly very popular in the Amazon. But the flower structure is very interesting with this very elaborate structure. And most of them are pollinated by large insects and hummingbirds. But this one, the red passion flower, is a very, very attractive one. And this is one of the commonest ones along roadsides, because it soon establishes in destroyed areas, as well as in the forest where it is usually native. Member of the Verbena family, Petraea, another beautiful riverside plant. I'm going to go through, as I see time is going on quickly. There are various parasitic plants with no green leaves. This one, like our various toothworts and others without any chlorophyll, but you get these in the Amazon too. A gentian that is parasitic, that has no chlorophyll in it. And then the Heliconiaceae, related to bananas, that are also very common. Or the pineapple family. Many members of the pineapple family grow in trees. The pineapple is terrestrial on the ground, but most of its relatives, over 1,000, are what are called epiphytes, perched up on the trees, like this one or this one. Some very beautiful colors in the pineapple family, because they're mainly pollinated by birds. And so you can see the red and purple colors to attract the pollinators. I was once asked in a radio program, if I were to survive in the Amazon, in a desert island, what plant family would I like to take with me to survive? And I said the palms, because you can do everything with the palms. You can build your house, thatch your house. You can eat the fruit like the peach palm here. You can get oil from it for your cooking. Many, many other things. This one, that grows in swamp areas. So you can see a vast colony of it, which is unusual for plants in the Amazon. And the fruit down below, which is rich in vitamin C, and it's used as a flavor in ice creams and desserts in the Amazon. And I want to finish by just showing a few orchids, because there are a lot of orchids, but I've concentrated more on some other plants of the Amazon. But the orchids too are very important. And as you know, it's one of the largest plant families in the world. We have just a very small flora of orchids compared with many parts of the world in the tropics. Cattleya, we see large hybrid cattleyas used in horticulture, but this is the native cattleya, in the Amazon. And it's very beautiful on the trees beside the river. This one has the name Cattleya nobilior, the noble cattleya, which is very appropriate for such a beautiful flower. But orchids come in all sorts of sizes and shapes, and they are nearly all growing on trees as epiphytes. They're not parasites, they just use the trees as perches. So here are two, Galeandra on the right there is a very common one beside the rivers in open places. And here is an Epiphyllum, one of the common genus of orchids. And this one's called Rodriguezia. This is a tiny one, actually. I don't have a scale in the photo, but this was a very small one. And then this one is the vanilla orchid. Did you know that the vanilla pods that you get come from an orchid that grows in the Amazon and in Central America from Mexico to southern Brazil? And this is one of the orchids in the genus Vanilla. It's been taken and cultivated very much in Madagascar, but it is a native of the Amazon rainforest. And I finish with just some sad news of what's happening in the Amazon today. Fire. And this is the loss of forest in 2021. So that recently, you can see in the southern part of the Amazon how much destruction of the forest there's been, and it's creeping up into the main part of it. And wherever you go in Colombia, Peru, Brazil, there are. Down here we see an area in February 21. We'll get that one again. You'll see February 21 and in September how much more of the forest has been cut. And that particular area was to plant oil palm, to use for oil palm, which is something that we use in so many products. But we want to make sure if we do use it, it's from sustainable sources. So there you are. I'm afraid we're losing a lot of those wonderful things in the Amazon forest, but there is still about 75% of the forest left. So that's why I'm fighting hard for the preservation of the Amazon forest, which I love so much. So I hope you've enjoyed some of those plants, and I'd be happy to answer any questions that any of you have.